Hi, everyone. Thanks so much for joining. We're about to get started. The session will be recorded. I'll just check in with my co-hosts, make sure everyone's ready to go, and then we'll launch in. We've got lots of interesting material to cover, and we appreciate you making the time to be here today. Benny and David, if you're both ready, could you turn on your cameras if that's possible where you are? And I'll start with a quick introduction. Great. So this session is meant to cover kind of how the new human rights due diligence laws that we're seeing kind of pop up in Europe, but also in Japan, in Australia, and other places are affecting supply chains, and particularly the relationship between suppliers and buyers. What we have intended for this session is to give you some best practices, tips, and, you know, kind of real stories from participants in global supply chains about how human rights due diligence is affecting their business, challenges that they've encountered, and ways that they've found to kind of move the conversation forward in ways that are beneficial to everyone working in the supply chain. My name is Jen Green. I'm the Senior Director of Partnerships and Content at Labor Solutions. We are a tech company based in Southeast Asia that helps suppliers and brands understand human rights risks in their supply chains and manage them through engagement with workers and a variety of scalable digital tools. Joining me today, we have Mr. Benny Chan from Sky. He's the Sustainability and Compliance Manager based in Hong Kong, and David Forsgate, who's the Chief Representative Officer for Aralda, Indonesia. Both of our guests today have extensive experience kind of in managing the relationships in supply chains and have gotten to see firsthand, you know, how this works and what changes are being made. So without further ado, I'm going to share my screen for a quick introduction to myself. I'll make a few kind of remarks about the context that we're working in and where all of this discussion of supply chains comes from. And then I'll turn it over to our guests. Great. So Labor Solutions has been around for almost 10 years now. We work with 1.7 million workers in over 26 languages and 36 countries. And that means we have over 600 brands and suppliers that we work with globally in a variety of different types of industries. And so we've been working with all of these partners in different places around the world and different types of manufacturing and production cycles, you know, to figure out what human rights means and how to track the correct data and how to do something positive with it. So what we want you to take away from this session is to understand the roles of both buyers and factories or other suppliers in implementing due diligence. We want to share some good or best practices. It may be early to say best in this situation, but the best that we know so far for industry stakeholders to protect human rights. And then we're going to look at what we call a supplier-centric approach for achieving human rights risk-free supply chains. Now, of course, there are always going to be some risks. But yeah, what we can do is make sure that the correct processes and decision trees are in place. I wanted to kind of start with making sure that we're all on the same page about what we mean by human rights due diligence. So sometimes called HRDD, human rights due diligence, or HREDD, human rights and environmental due diligence, or HRDD, mandatory human rights due diligence. It's really a kind of catch-all phrase that is describing a category of corporate regulations that are being enacted around the world. The purpose of these regulations is to create incentives for our kind of European and other kind of brands and multinationals to actually be more proactive in engaging with the risks and issues that are happening in their suppliers. You know, we all know that for a long time, It's been very easy to kind of push risk down the supply chain by simply contracting out or outsourcing. And what these laws are trying to do is actually to bring those risks and that knowledge and that responsibility, you know, back to buyers. And that's actually good news for everyone. It means that we'll have a more level playing field. And it should mean that there are going to be better incentives for good behavior. So generally, these laws require one or more of a variety of types of actions, processes, tools, governance, and documentation. So a process is, you know, something that companies have to do in order to, kind of fulfill the legal requirements. It could be an annual review. It could be, you know, kind of questionnaires. These types of processes are meant to be built in to get companies to, you know, kind of not just do a one-time, you know, kind of assessment, but to have a process that continually revisits both their approach and the effectiveness of the approach. Second is tools. Many of the human rights due diligence regulations that we're seeing require specific types of tools, like a complaints mechanism or a grievance mechanism. So that's something to be aware of. Governance is, you know, the requirement that there be a certain person or structure for decision-making within a company. Several of the human rights due diligence regulations require something like a human rights officer. That's specifically the German Human Rights Supply Chain Due Diligence Act. And, you know, in other places, it might be a committee or just, you know, a designee to be the person of contact. The fourth type of requirement that falls under these laws is documentation. And this is, you know, something where you're kind of showing your work about how you're complying. Often this could mean a human rights policy, which is required under the two major, the European directive that's being come through is requiring a due diligence policy, plus reporting. Reporting is, of course, a type of documentation that requires a company to both show their results and also, in many cases, to justify what their actions are. So those are the types of things that companies that fall under these new legislations will be required to do. Now, what, you know, do these duties look like? This is just kind of a graphic to show you how we look at them. I think there are a few different types of duties. One is design. It's kind of a big global risk assessment of business areas and jurisdictions. And then you have this kind of continuous process of identifying specific issues that as they arise, preventing new issues, which could be through processes or education, remediate, which means to do something when a violation happens, to put the impacted people back in a position where they have good conditions and proper access. And then assess is to, you know, understand the range of risks that could arise through regular risk analysis. And this often happens through things like stakeholder mapping and engagement and risk mapping. And then, of course, annually, there's usually a duty of some kind to report. So this is, you know, in general, what we're talking about. And it's not just, you know, the German law or even the CSDDD that we're talking about. Human rights due diligence laws have many different kind of names and look slightly different in different places, but they are increasingly common around the world. New Zealand has newly proposed a modern slavery law, which is looking at the specific human rights issue of forced labor. Japan has released at the end of last year guidelines on corporate HRDD, which they aren't planning to make legislation, but they're binding guidelines. Of course, Australia and you've many European countries, as well as the US and Canada. So this is not an issue that's just for a small segment of us who are only working with buyers in one country. This is, you know, fast becoming the norm. And I think, yeah, this trend is, you know, trying to really embed more responsible business practices into global supply chains. And I think that's a good thing for all of us. So, you know, what's new or different about the EU directive on corporate sustainability due diligence, which is often rather confusing. interestingly, shortened to CSDDD. So this is, of course, also intended to prevent violations of human rights and environmental obligations, and to ensure that there are common standards for businesses throughout the EU. Now, the interesting thing, of course, about EU regulations is that they don't automatically come into effect. They have to then be enacted by each country, and each country has some ability to kind of change specific provisions within a certain scope. And so we don't yet know exactly how the CSDDD will look when it is enacted in all of the countries that comprise the EU. But in general, you know, the duties here do look very similar to the German Supply Chain Act. So having a due diligence policy or human rights policy, complaints mechanism, prevention and remediation. So both, you know, kind of making sure that ahead of time you do your best to make sure nothing happens. And when things do happen, being active in solving the problems and putting people back in the position they would be in before. Also reporting and reviewing the effectiveness of your program. Now, what's different about the EU legislation is the scope, both in terms of what types of companies would be subject to the legislation and what part of the supply chain would fall kind of within the directive. And it is, of course, much broader than the German legislation. And yeah, I'll let you all read up on that. But certainly, I think that is one of the big things. Currently, the German legislation, which came into effect on January 1st, only applies to German companies with over 3,000 employees. So actually, very few German companies are, you know, within that scope. And so we aren't seeing a lot of movement yet on German human rights due diligence. But, you know, that is scaling up in the next 3 years. And so we will, you know, see an increasing amount of discussion about this as I think the requirements become more clear. And what's interesting about these laws is also they, you know, they do have big consequences in terms of fines and things like that for non-compliance. But I think there's also kind of an underlying you know, kind of message that what is being done here is kind of changing incentives to push people towards further engagement. And it's not supposed to be, you know, a tick box kind of compliance law. And so it's much more about making sure that companies kind of adopt this approach rather than, you know, like, do you fulfill A, B, and C? And so I think that that's a difficult shift for many, you know, legal and compliance departments to get their heads around. And I think it will, you know, be something that is being discussed and in the courts for a while. So we may not have, you know, a really good answer to what is required. But of course, what we can do is we can see what this law is supposed to mean. And, you know, we can try to actually embody the spirit of that law. So what does this mean for suppliers? You know, many of you in this room are probably not in the countries that have a human rights due diligence law. So how, why is it impacting you and how? And that's a great question. Of course, what does happen is not what's supposed to happen, which is that legal requirements of buyers just get pushed down the chain and become the problem of people who are not part of those legal regimes anyways. But yes, of course, if you are not in Europe or Germany or Japan or these other countries, you may not have a direct legal obligation to comply with HRDD laws, but you may see that your contracts start to change to reflect the additional information and additional kind of conditions that your buyers need in order to fulfill their legal obligations. So this is still a bit of a kind of top-down process, but what it also says is that your buyers, once they engage with you, have additional obligations to you. So it's not a one-way kind of pushing down. There are what we like to refer to as mutual obligations that become part of these laws. So that includes your buyers being required to support the identification, prevention, and remediation of violations. And just to point out here that bad business practices are bad for suppliers as well. You know, we know that when employees are treated badly, when there are safety issues, you know, these create working environments that are not as productive, that have high turnovers, which means high recruitment and training costs, that they have higher levels of defects, and that overall they you know, they aren't as cheap as they sound. And so actually, you know, one of the other kind of benefits of this is that if you're a company that already does things well, other companies will have to rise to your standards. And that means that on a cost basis, you know, you will be able to, yeah, kind of compete more fairly with companies that are required to have the same standards and safeguards as you. So especially for companies that are trying to do well and trying to, you know, engage and protect workers, this is actually only good news. And yeah, I think from here, I'm going to, sign off with a couple of slides, which is to say that, yeah, the duty to analyze risks and the duty to undertake follow-up measures are not designed as a duty to succeed. We know that there will always be risks, but a duty to use one's best efforts. And so we don't expect, and I think one of the important things about designing an approach to effective human rights due diligence is acknowledging that there will be risks and there should be risks, because this is kind of how our world operates. There's no way to make a risk-free environment, and it's not efficient. And so what we want to do is just create processes that create the safest place possible, but also allow us to resolve issues when they come up as easily as possible. So yeah, we're not expecting perfection here from anyone. And any kind of system that penalizes issues, is bound kind of, I think, for failure, because that will just incentivize people not to identify issues. And then last, yeah, I think, you know, from Labor Solutions perspective, and this is just kind of a quick plug, we see, you know, these things as working, you know, as not a timeline, but as things that you should be working on together. So designing a risk assessment management system, you know, means reaching out to stakeholders, means doing media scraping and using, you know, digital tools to understand, you know, kind of what's happening in different sectors and industries. It means looking at kind of industry experts and consultants who are publishing heat maps and other types of global risk assessments, so that you have a baseline and you know what is likely to be a risk in your supply chains in certain industries and geographies. Secondly, is to look at specific risks. You know, when you look at kind of a global map that says, region, in this industry, this issue is very common, but you never know whether that's an issue in your specific supply chain unless you ask. And so then, yeah, having things like complaints and grievance mechanisms and other tools can help to actually identify what's happening in your specific supply chain. Surveys can also serve this type of function. We, of course, provide e-learning. Making sure that workers know what their rights are helps them to better kind of utilize these types of tools and to, you know, kind of report, what is really happening. But then, of course, it's important to follow that up with prevention and remediation. When workers raise issues, when suppliers raise issues, you need to be active and responsive. Otherwise, the trust is difficult to maintain because there isn't, you know, kind of real accountability for that support. I think, you know, what we do is we provide different types of solutions that may be appropriate in different types of supply chains. This isn't the only way to address HRDD requirements, but certainly, more data from the source is going to be part of the solution. And so certainly, looking at quality of data and not just quantity of data is something that I would underline here. And also, talking to people who know the context. There's only so much that a kind of global consultancy can tell you about what's, you know, kind of the experience of workers and what is, you know, kind of the pressures that suppliers have in the places that you work. And so having good networks and having good communication, I think, is especially critical under these new laws. And opening those lines of communication and ensuring that there is, you know, kind of two ways and that there's trust kind of built into your supply chain relationships is a great way forward. And now I'm going to hand the mic over to our first speaker, Mr. Benny Chan from Sky. Benny, are you able to unmute yourself? And there you go. Take it away. We're not able to hear online. Yeah, thank you.
I think it should be okay now. Okay, sorry about that. So good afternoon. Great to meet all of you here in Bangkok, as well as those joining virtual. Yang, we have about 30, 40 people on site with me. Okay, so this is a bit unexpected, but this is great to meet all of you. So I think Yang has introduced me a bit. Okay, I'm from Sky, okay, which is a UK company and UK-based podcaster since 1990. Okay, we are headquartered in Austerlitz, London. I think if you were in UK or you lived there before, you know this is the household name. Okay, we not only provide a TV channel, okay, paid TV, sport, etc., but we also provide telecommunication service to our customer, broadband, or as well as Wi-Fi. Okay, not only personal but also residential and business. We are the largest one so far, okay, the media player in the region. And we not only offer service in UK, but also in other European countries like Ireland, Germany, as well as Italy. We have more than 30,000 employees in the world, and we are serving more than 23 million customers, mainly in Europe. And since 2018, okay, we have been part of a Comcast. If you have some idea or you were in the state, you know that Comcast is the giant player in telecommunication and entertainment industry. So, and both of us are RBA member, okay, with a responsible business alliance member. So how about myself? I have been working in the CSR industry more than 20 years. I'm from Hong Kong. Most of my job are Hong Kong based. I have a lot of factories, I would say, in different industry, more than 1,500 worldwide, not only in Asia, but also like in Europe, Middle East, as well as Africa. Even Mongolia, even some challenging name, even Mauritius, people go to there for honeymoon, but I go there for auditing. Unfortunately, okay. So, I trust that I'm good at stakeholder engagement, which is important part in DD. Without having the right people engaged, okay, this is hard for us to proceed. Definitely, we have a lot of internal training to make sure that our teammates within the same organization are on the same page, and we have serving the same goal. And we do have exercise a different level of training to our suppliers and factories, depending on how good or how bad they are. If they are in a difficult position or situation, okay, we will exercise some tailor-made support to them. So after my graduation, I worked for PVH as an auditor. You may know the name is a apparel brand in the state. It owns currency like Tommy Hilfiger as well as Calvin Klein. I also worked for Migros more than 3 years, which is the household name in Switzerland. Radio Shack, I think it did not exist anymore. Okay, but it was a great consumer electronic retailers in the state as well as in Mexico. Biltima, anyone of you from Nordic countries? Okay, Biltima is the household name in the Scandinavian, Norway, Denmark, okay, which is something like a IKEA or B&Q. You sell everything except food. I joined Sky last September, and my key responsibility include the risk assessment against our supplier, which is very important to determine the risk level. It is very important because it determines how much resources we spend to them and how what are the priorities are. And our RBA audit, we did some smatter audit before. Okay, I will share a bit such information later. Worker survey, we partner with our consultancy, including Labor Solution, to conduct worker survey at tier one, which is very important to get the employees' voices. Conflict mineral, okay, VTG, you may know, okay, to make sure that the revenue or the income from the mineral not going to the armed groups or an ethical organization. Green factories, okay, we expect our factory to exercise a carbon emission target, net zero in sky. Okay, our target is the reduce the emission by 50% 2030 and 95% by 2050. So this slide simply show you our journey. Okay, from 2012 when we start our DD program. Okay, so I would say 2014 we start do auditing at our supplier in terms of social compliance, and 2015 is a big was a big year for us because UK launched Modern Slavery Act. Okay, which make all of us to be more responsible and more accountable for their supply chain. And next year, we work with SMETA for the first audit. And then afterward, we joined RBA since 2017, and which is a kind of our Bible, okay, in executing our DD program. It supply a lot useful information, researchers to back up our work plan with our suppliers, also internally. So we keep renovating our practices because I think, yes, as Jen mentioned that, okay, laws are changing, okay, we are expected to keep updating ourselves to make sure that all legal requirements could be met. So from our perspective, why we need HRDD, okay, it has been a global trend. Before, it was voluntary, but if you but your partner or your customer are mainly from Europe or from the state, okay, this is unavoidable. It has been mandatory. As mentioned, 2015, we have a UK a Modern Slavery Act. And earlier, okay, we have a California Transparency in Supply Chain Act. So all of them are expect us to be a good citizen. And lately, we have a EU, okay, Corporate Sustainability Due Diligence Directive, which has been mentioned by Jan already, which is quite demanding, but from my point of view, it's reasonably demanding. Okay, we are moving to another level. As again, we be reminded that, okay, DD is not voluntary anymore. It has been mandatory. And not optional, okay, like other requirement. There are some example like radio equipment, there are directive, product safety legislation, and EMS legislation. Why I mentioned this requirement? Because we sell TV, television, router, home security devices, as well as a set-top box to our customer. So our suppliers have to follow this requirement on product side as well. So yeah, now DD is newly required, and we expect that, okay, buyers should have a sort of obligation, responsibility, and accountability in governing and overseeing the supply chain due diligence performance. And it will make themselves, okay, I mean, the supply will be more competitive, and you will harmonize, okay, I would say, the relationship between your with your supplier as your with your customer as well. So we always have challenge, including same as you, okay, from different areas. Okay, I just go through them briefly. For example, we don't have a good bargaining power or negotiation power with our all suppliers. Some of them are tier two, tier three. Okay, we need to exercise a lot of lobbying or effort in motivating them to make the changes. Okay, for sure, we have enjoyed some good bargaining power with our tier one factory. Okay, but we never ignore tier two or tier three. Okay, those are also in a poor DD conditions. Legal legislation, which is quite clear from Yen, okay, not only Europe, not only the state, okay, Mexico, okay, as well as Australia, New Zealand, Japan have introduced a similar similar approach already. Okay, unless you are only working for some, I would say, the country are less demanding on this area. Otherwise, you may still keep your eye closed on this year, maybe for another 2-3 years. But I think it's not true that, and this is not appropriate that you ignore this area, which will be more and more important. Important suppliers. Many of our suppliers are good, but they are incapable of dealing with the issue. Okay, they have commitment, but they don't have idea or resources or knowledge to do so. So we do need to spend a lot of resources, including some tailor-made training to bring them out. And as mentioned, we have a tier one, tier two, and some tier three. How about another tier three and more? Okay, this is also our challenge as well. And we have been carrying out measures to make our program more penetrated. There are two big circles, forced labor and recruitment fee. They are always highly linked together. Okay, especially in countries, those are importing foreign workers. In the region like Taiwan, a lot of factories there import workers from, Philippines, Thai, Vietnam, and Indonesian as well. Okay, unfortunately, we sometimes find that the worker situation are not lovely, especially based on our previous employment, then their passport may be withheld, and they are subject to paying huge recruitment fee in their home country as well as in the employment country. And so these are definitely our key concern. Apart from Taiwan, similar issue may happen in Malaysia as well. In Malaysia, I think some of you might be from Malaysia. Okay, we found that a factory, just 200 workers, it has people from 10 countries. Okay, they are from Nepal, they are from India, Bangladesh. Okay, there are a lot of concern. Okay, not only about the languages, but about the culture. How did the factory communicate with them effectively to ensure their well-being is protected? So stakeholder expectation we need to cater. Okay, stakeholder, we are talking about our customer, internal bodies as well as our suppliers. We can ask suppliers to do a lot of work to make the registration fulfilled, but we need to balance it. Okay, we need to understand the situation. Okay, we are not the king. Okay, we always have a harmonize a partnership with our supplier to drive them to reach the target reasonably. External monitoring, okay, some media, some NGO, I think we are not the only party, the only association being monitored or being overseen. Okay, from time to time, you may see that some big retailers have a factory in Bangladesh or in India, in China, okay, will uncover some unethical employment practice, etc. So we do care about concern as well. So I think this is very important to get the buy-in from our supplier and from their sub-suppliers as well. So we need to engage the factories at different levels and industry. What do you mean at different level? Like what I mentioned, tier one, tier two, tier three. And if the factory, if the customer is a big customer, like a big supermarket, okay, they may need to engage the suppliers from different sector, food, hard goods, as well as soft goods, and get their voices as much as possible and show that their feedback could be incorporated as a part of the program, which is very important, especially for internal lobbying. It shows that their voices are adopted as well as their ideas are recognized. And in turn, okay, you will receive less resistance from your partner. Always offer help, assistance, and support to the suppliers. As mentioned, we offer some general training, but also tailor-made training, okay, like capacity building and remediation. and try to assist them to carry out the corrective action instead of just, okay, you have to do this, you have to do that. Try to understand the root causes. Okay, sometimes the causes may be from our company. Okay, maybe the lead time is too short. Okay, not reasonable, or the delivery of the packs, okay, from tier two to tier one is missing. So we need to identify. And then we arrange consultancy for education and coaching on different topics, like recruitment fee issue. Okay, we do alert. We are very alert on this very much, because it could be a kind of a modern slavery or a forced labor issue. Financially, for example, from us, we may subsidize some improvement project as long as reasonable and affordable. And make sure that we also deliver some political updates to our supplier to make sure that they are aware about the update legal legislation and the requirement. And then we conduct a political update and review with our suppliers, okay, to make sure that they understand the issue and they are prepared for the upcoming changes, like CSDDD, okay, grade funds mechanism, not only from CSDDD, but also from German Act as well. Okay, they have to be prepared. And as a part of the annex of a CSDDD, living wages are coming as well. So let them know the challenge ahead and let them prepare in advance. Transparency for us is top priority. Without transparency, we cannot move on. And we try to make the relationship as collaborative as possible. Okay, some customer may think that, okay, the factories are cunning, are dishonest, but they are not true. Okay, we if you don't trust the supplier, or your suppliers don't trust you, the relationship won't last long, definitely. Okay, and then your supply chain and your business will be unstable. So from my point of view, there are some areas we need to focus on, okay, to build the system. First of all, top management buy-in. This is unavoidable. And tell them again that, okay, this is not optional anymore, sir. Okay. And you may also share some nightmare experienced by another supplier or by another big payers or retailers, how their situation was. Okay. For example, child labor was found in the supply chain, or a recruitment fee issue, or withholding passport issue were identified in one of the suppliers. Let them know that the advantage from being compliant, keep the business running, definitely, and give more confidence to your customer and be more competitive. I trust that, okay, some factories are still primitive or still backward in exercising the DD strategy, but they will be disadvantaged in the supply chain, definitely. And as a management, be long-sighted. Not just think about what I'm going to do tomorrow or next month or by end of this year. But, you know, when the legislation comes into force, we know the timeline, what will be in place, okay, by different time slot. So be prepared for it. Not only the manpower, but also for the resources. And offer proper resources and support. Definitely. And delegation is very important. When we are in the factory, okay, we ask, okay, hey, who is in charge of the DD? 10 people come here. Okay, but there's a local person to master the issue. This is very important to have such kind of delegation and balance among the internal and internal stakeholders. The boss or the management need to have balance, not only listen the voices from the marketing or from the revenue department, okay? But on the other hand, okay, they need to exercise good support to the DD team. Intervention when need, and okay, they need to be regularly reported. This is very important. So qualified specialists, you need to have the right people to execute the program. Official delegation is important. Let all people in the organization know that this person is in charge now, and he is or she is supposed to be capable of overseeing all DD issue. Not only to have excellent knowledge, okay? There's a no ceiling, I would say that, okay? But have a good DD knowledge, then they can communicate with the supplier and internal bodies sufficiently. Instead of, hey, what's the standard about the working hours in Malaysia, in Philippines? But and the guy may be stuck here. I don't know. I just read the report, okay? So it will wound his credibility. I mean, not only the person, but also the system. So this person has to communicate and negotiate with internal and external stakeholders and must be a strong team player. Okay, they can connect people. And then, as mentioned, have a good channel to report and escalate any issue to the boss or to the top management. Building a DD, management system, stakeholder engagement is important, especially internal bodies. If you are not listening to them, they will give you line mail afterward, definitely. Okay, you need to get their voices in the earlier stage, incorporate their ideas into action, show your respect to them. They are helping you. You guys are in the same organization. There will be no disadvantage if they make you in trouble. Okay, but make sure that they are respected and all the pieces within the organization should be well connected. So communication and consultation are fundamentally important. So you need to establish a policy and SOP, okay? But before doing so, you may need to have some soft launch as well as a hard launch, not just go to issue or publish something without consultation, without letting the people in. Periodical review, definitely. Okay, changes from time to time, you need to be prepared. Training and monitoring, not only internal body, but also selected, I would say, supplier or sub-supplier to make your program strengthen. And to a certain extent, to brainwash them to know the importance of the DD in the world. Internal audit, tracking are also necessary. And the program is definitely subject to periodical review and enhancement. So this is the last slide, okay? This is difficult, but everyone want to be the best in the class, okay? Some idea, I'm not professional, okay, but I will share some idea from our working experience. Take the highest standard as goal. I can tell you that if you are serving 5 customers from Europe, they are also restricted by the CSDDD. They will require you to do very differently. Some of them may just provide me a self-declaration. That's it. Okay. All of us happy because I just need to sign, take some boxes, done. But some of them, like us, okay, we are travel guy, okay? We need to have a risk assessment. We need to do the audit, okay? Try to take the highest standard. Otherwise, your job afterward will be repeated and repeated. And you will consume you more resources and manpower afterward, okay? Because finally, you still need to reach that status. The law is requiring. Regular update on the legal requirement. This is important. Otherwise, you will doing something on the outdated requirement. You waste your time. Regular communication with your customer and suppliers. Okay, know what they think, and especially know your sub-supplier, how good or how bad they are. Okay, then you have some idea how hardworking you need to be. Okay, with them. Task prioritization. When I reviewed the audit report from a factory, unfortunately, I found some of them, not all of them, okay? Some of them have 30 issues, 40 issues. I almost fall down from the chair, okay? But I sit on the ground, so I cannot fall down from the chair, okay? So the point is, okay, you have a lot to do. Prioritize, okay? not do the easier things first, but the most important thing first. If you are not sure, check with your customer. They will give you idea, okay? Spend the resources wisely because we always have limited resources. Supply chain mapping, know your supply chain well, please. Okay, otherwise, you don't know what to do. Okay, in my previous employment, I don't know we have a factory in Bangladesh. Okay, I don't know that factory in Bangladesh was working for us because the procurement team did not inform us. This could be very dangerous. I'm not talking about Bangladesh, but it could be in Taiwan, it could be in Malaysia, Philippines, everywhere. You need to know where your suppliers are and how good or how bad they are. Study before actions. Don't waste your resources. Sub-supplier management. As mentioned from CSDDD, and also in general, you need to be prepared. Grievance mechanism. Listen to workers' voices and living wages approach will be the agenda very soon. So thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Your turn. Sorry, maybe overrun a bit. That's okay. There's so much to cover. But yeah, I do want to turn it over to David to also share, you know, from a different sector and different types of supply chains. Yeah, kind of how, yeah, David, can you tell us a bit about your context and what your experience has been in implementing HRDD? And then, yeah, everyone, if you have questions, please use the Q&A button and we'll get to as many as we can at the end. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jen. Thank you, Benny. That was a fantastic presentation. Very, very interesting overlaps with how we work as well, particularly in terms of trusting suppliers and respecting them. Because I think, you know, it's just like with people. If you trust and respect people, you'll get that back. And I think, you know, managing supply chains is really trying to build relationships and true partnerships. And the extent that you can do that really will determine your success at mitigating risks. So my name is David. I'm British, but born in Hong Kong. I'm now living in Jakarta in Indonesia, and I'm the Chief Representative Officer of HRDD, Indonesia here. Our company is based in the apparel and sourcing sector for clothing. So actually we got introduced to Labor Solutions through Eileen Fisher, which is quite a well-known US-based brand. And one of the reasons why it's so well-known is because their approach to social impact and also environmental sustainability. To that end, they're actually a B Corporation. I don't know if you've come across this certificate, everyone, but I highly recommend you have a look at it. The standards really are about trying to become the best possible when it comes to social and environmental impact as well as profit. And I think a lot of what that process does is drive up standards across the board for a company. So we ourselves, we're actually an aspiring B Corporation also. We have 50 years of expertise across cut and sewn garments, woven outerwear, denim and sweaters. We're a family business. We have about 100 employees. We're based in Hong Kong, Ho Chi Minh, and Jakarta in Indonesia. And there's just two things I just wanted to kind of highlight in terms of what our approach is. I don't have a presentation, so this will be brief, and then we can jump to the questions. I've seen some good ones asked by Jay about good practice, and Mr. Arifuddin about reporting incidents. So we'll get to those soon. So two things I just wanted to highlight really was, what processes do you put in place, and how do you do that? And I think Benny, you know, had a fantastic framework there. One thing that I pick out from what we do is we work with an organization called Better Work Indonesia. Better Work is an ILO, IFC funded organization. And essentially they really try and work to lift the standards of the garment industry. So the program, they really protect human rights by conducting assessments. They develop remediation plans, they provide training advisory services, promote social dialogue, collaborate with stakeholders. And the evaluation of the factories, I think, is key. And unlike a one-off audit, Better Work actually works throughout the whole year. So you get regular feedback, you get regular corrective action plans. You know, I read through the reports every time they're released and look at any potential non-compliance findings. And then myself, I can get on the phone to the head of the factory who's based down the road from me here, say, hey, what's going on with this particular issue? How are you going to resolve it? What's the action plan? When I first moved to Indonesia, I went to a Better Work conference. I have to say, work conferences can sometimes be a bit dull or a bit de-energizing, but I have to say, this was one of the best conferences I've ever been to in my life. The energy in the room was just incredible, and the data presented was also brilliant. I actually have a background in social impact analysis. That's what I used to do in London before moving into this sector and into this business. And the way that the data is collected and then improved upon, used to improve upon, I think is just absolutely fantastic. And I think on a very basic level, when it comes to human rights due diligence or even environmental due diligence, you know, a data analytical approach is vital. You know, get a baseline. Where are you at? Then number two is, you know, how are you going to set goals to that? Then monitor yourself on how you're doing it and then try and improve. And that, I think, approach, you know, that simple approach, three-step or four-step approach, is one that could be used here in simple terms. So just to highlight a couple of wins from the Better Work approach, they actually had a 10-year reflection report, which they produced last year. It's successful on their website, it's well worth reading. And they have data to link to show that compliance improvements in the lives of workers have been achieved. For example, women are more likely to vocalize their opinions the longer Better Work have operated in their factory, and also health and access to healthcare has improved in their factories as well. So besides Better Work, we also actually did work with Labour Solutions, i.e. Fisher themselves commissioned a gender equity and wellbeing survey. And on the back of those surveys, we also worked with Labour Solutions on focus groups. So those focus groups came into the different factories that we work here within Indonesia. They had about 30 people, on balance, 25 women, 5 men, and went through each and every step on a human rights perspective, how they were engaged with the factory, were there any issues. And I think, I guess what is fantastic about being able to bring in expertise, again, as Benny said, and I would classify Labour Solutions as the expertise here, is they really get into the detail. So from our approach, Better Work is fantastic, it's excellent, but also if you can bring in further expertise, then why not? Because again, you're minimizing risk further and further and getting closer to that. So my second point that I just want to finish with is about communication, involvement, and getting on the ground. At HRDD, we have quality control personnel in every factory that we work in. And I think that really sets us apart from other sourcing agents in terms of we're in the factory, we're able to see what's going on, we're able to talk to the workers on a day-to-day basis. And I think, you know, in the old days, people used to just, you know, send out an email and respect an email response. But I think today you really have to go on site. You really have to be there in the room, you know, and I went to a potential new factory last week, and sometimes things on paper aren't the same as you actually going to the site. You know, you get to go see where the workers eat, you know, go to the canteens, go to the toilets, ask a member of staff to really, really go there and put yourself in the shoes of the workers, because I think that's absolutely key. From a human rights approach, and that's certainly our approach in how we do things. So that's just a little overview on how we work. Slightly conscious of time, I want to allow questions. So let me turn that back to you, Jen.
Great, thank you, David. Yeah, I think, you know, it's super interesting to hear from, you know, both kind of a fabric garment kind of perspective and Benny's, which is more kind of hardware electronics. You know, a lot of these issues are the same. It's really about kind of trying to empathize with suppliers, understand that they're business people who are also trying to run their businesses, you know, and finding solutions that benefit them as well as benefiting, buyers in the West. And I agree, let's see what questions we can get to in the time that we have left. So from Jay, we have, what barriers and resistance have you seen in these measures from suppliers, and how do you encourage them? So if Benny, do you have any specific examples of, you know, a time that a supplier has, you know, kind of pushed back on some new requirements?
I think one of the reasons is they are not familiar or they are not aware of the importance of the issue. And then their management has not exercised proper support to them. And as I mentioned, okay, they haven't awakened them that, okay, the DD has been mandatory. So I we fully understand that this is uneasy, especially from the beginning. But if you keep not stepping out, okay, nothing will happen. And then you will ruin your business in long term. And from time to time, okay, there are a lot of organization like RBA or et cetera, okay, can offer the suppliers, okay, to different information. But for sure, there may be some, maybe apparel brands, okay, may have another different organization can give them support. So from my end, if my supplier have a concern, okay, I don't know what to do. In the organization, I'm the person to help them. But it also depends on how other retailers or how other brands are willing to help, how much or not. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And I loved, Benny, that you mentioned financial support, because of course, you know, a lot of these extra measures, extra engagement, experts, you know, these things are all things that cost money. And a lot of our suppliers are already, you know, kind of very cost conscious, because they know that that's what we're looking for as buyers, is to, yeah, kind of have a low price. And so, yeah, I think it's fair that we say, hey, look, we're not going to, yeah, kind of either give you that cost, or we're not going to, you know, kind of, yeah, force you to keep prices low, even while we're putting these extra costs on you. So I think that's a great, yeah, that's a great example. David, any specific examples come to mind for you?
Not a specific example, but I think ultimately, again, it's about trying to be collaborative as possible and saying, look, you know, what is your issue here with this particular regulation? And then trying to figure out how to get over that. And usually there is a way. If there's not, then you probably shouldn't be with that supplier. I'm in quite a privileged position because we're quite a boutique agency that we work with predominantly premium brands who do actually pay that premium as well, that can enable the supplier to make those investments that's needed. So I think I'm in a bit of a privileged position in that kind of part of the supply chain. But whenever we've had a hurdle or an issue that we've needed the supplier's help on, they've always been usually willing to partner. So again, you know, maybe there's that work up front that needs to be done to say, you know, who are the kind of suppliers that we want to be with? Do they have that growth mindset and also that approach to human rights that is in line with our values?
Yeah, absolutely. And actually, I'm of the opinion that that's why these are all called due diligence laws. Due diligence is actually the work that you do before you contract. And of course, these laws are much more about the support that you have to provide afterwards. But that means that the important decision point is exactly as you say, David, whether or not to engage with a particular partner in the supply chain. And because that has extra responsibilities, it's important to pick partners that are aligned, that can, yeah, work on your terms, and that, yeah, can kind of carry through. So yeah, absolutely agree that it's important. And also to examine your business model and practices, right? If you're, you know, making orders at the last minute as a buyer, if you're, yeah, you know, kind of pushing down a lot of pressure on costs and things like that, then you're actually, yeah, kind of giving your suppliers not much choice in terms of how they run their business. And so I think, yeah, being aware of responsible buying practices is also really key to making sure that the business models can support this additional responsibility. Great. Yeah, let's see the next question. Public, where is the public participation if we want to submit human rights violations in certain companies or in their supply chain? And what HRDD rules on this kind of report to companies and supply chain? David, did you have something on that you mentioned?
Yeah, it depends, I guess, which perspective this is coming from. I used to work in the NGO area. So from that perspective, I'd say talk to your activists. You know, do you have a particular or a union or other activists that might be able to raise the issue for you? If you're an individual that has a relationship within with that company that you have a problem with, perhaps write to the director and say, or the directors and say, look, this is an issue. It's unacceptable. What are you going to do about it? You know, I've done that once on an environmental issue and had a very positive response and an immediate kind of action taken there. So those are just two solutions that might be helpful.
Great. Yeah. Benny, did you have any insight onto, kind of how public can be involved in reporting and other channels there?
If I understand correctly, actually, we have a Sky Listen, so Comcast Listen, to let the public share, if any deviation or bribery or ethical issue to us, And our supply chain, we have pushed or we have motivated all our suppliers to have its own grievance mechanism. However, we think that it may be insufficient. So we are also working with RBA as well as some labor consultancy to see how far our footprints could be part of their grievance mechanism as well. So this is very challenging because they already have a system. Why you need to modify it? You don't trust my system or you think your system is best? No, but we need to have a kind of a compromise or share more responsibility in our supply chain.
Definitely.
In the room, there may be some questions. Please leave some time to do so, okay?
Let's take a break and take some questions in the room, actually. Benny, would you be able to help facilitate that?
The gentleman next to me, you're the second one, okay.
Hi, my name is Eric, I'm with Embode. So the global conversation around HRDD is very often focused on the supply chain actors. Now, one thing in your presentation that stood out was lead time. So I'd really like to hear from yourself, Benny, what Sky is doing around their buying practices, how they're looking at their own buying practices as part of their HRDD journey. Thank you.
Yeah, from our perspective, we work very closely with the T1, T2 factories, including the lead time and what kind of support they have. We always, unfortunately, have some delay shipment, because of the technical issue, as well as the factory themselves, and then we need to make compromise. In many cases, even they have a problem like excessive working hours, as long as the workers are paid properly, record properly, voluntarily, then we will give tolerance, but we will drive them to carry out improvement progressively to reach the, I would say, acceptable standard. We are not saying that no overtime, this is ridiculous. But we need to make the things more reasonable. And transparency is very important for us. The lady on the left raised her hand first, okay?
I just wanted to ask, and this could be to anybody, how do we avoid, these audits are the typical way that we, conduct due diligence and we check our work. How do we avoid that being just a tick boxing exercise? How do we make it more meaningful? Do you have any concrete examples of that? Because that's the fear that we run into in our work. And I think also even with audits, we have had experiences where we hear from factories that if they know an audit is happening, the workers are made aware. There's signs that go up and say, clean up shop, act in a certain way. Today, this is happening. How do we avoid these kind of issues to where the audit is just, kind of just something that they say they've done rather than something that's actually impactful?
Jen, you or yes. David or me?
Sure, I'll start, and it would be great to hear kind of both of your perspectives as well. Yes, well, I think as a service provider, labor solutions, we think audits are a spot check, right? They're not a solution. They're not a behavior change mechanism. They're a way of kind of going in once a year, as we say, or more often, and oftentimes scheduled or at least partially scheduled. And so they aren't, I think, a good tool of aligning interests and in kind of embedding new operations and management. That's something that we work on a lot at Labor Solutions. Our app is designed to be engaged with throughout the year and to also kind of provide some HR functions like a grievance tool, other types of kind of within factory or facility communications so that there can be announcements made and other information shared so that people are kind of using the portal as, you know, a kind of consistent way of communicating and then using that kind of consistent engagement as a way to, yeah, build trust and to reinforce the behaviors that we're looking for. So we do that through the types of metrics that we grab and also the type that we share. One thing that, you know, I talk about quite a lot is when we run a grievance tool with a factory, we don't report to their brand how many incidents have been reported. It's not helpful because what happens is that when you judge someone on how many incidents they have, they stop reporting incidents, right? And that's not the correct solution. So what we judge them on is how quickly there's a response and how satisfied workers are with that response. And what that does is says, you know, when an issue comes up, please be as responsive as you can. And please do it in a way that, yeah, that gets to the root of what workers are asking for. Because it's true, there are other channels. And what should happen is that, you know, grievances, safety issues, concerns should be resolved within, you know, the kind of supplier first. And then, you know, there are kind of outside channels if that's not safe or if that wasn't satisfactory. So, yeah, you've got unions, NGOs, media, human rights defenders, brands themselves who, yeah, as Benny said, might have their own whistleblower grievance channel, governments, multilaterals. You know, in Cambodia, for example, there's an employment arbitration council that handles worker complaints, and that's kind of a multi-stakeholder initiative. So, yeah, there's, I think, you know, designed to be, and not redundancies, but I think actually different kind of pathways that people can choose depending on what works best for them. But yeah, I think that you know, audits cannot be a good way of motivating people because they're very punitive, and employees know that they're punitive, and so employees don't want their employer to suffer, so they're not going to tell on them if they think that something that they say might be used against their workplace.
Okay, we take one more question from here and then move back to any question virtually, right? One of you.
Yeah, I'm with International Labor Rights Forum. And one thing that we really believe is that it's, you know, the key group that's able to verify working conditions in a workplace is workers themselves and their representative organizations, such as a union or other type of worker organization. So I was wondering in the sectors that you work, in the electronics sector or in the garment sector, how are you seeing companies cooperate with unions and other worker organizations in their human rights due diligence processes?
Yeah, I recently have a line mail from a supplier, okay, in one of the country, okay. It does not allow workers to be recruited directly. Otherwise, these workers are eligible to be the union member. So it hurts a lot, okay? And it wounds the workers' rights, which is out of our tolerance. So we stop all of them because luckily they have not been our supplier yet, okay? They are a potential supplier. So we stop using them, okay? And then we work with them to see what are the concerns and how far they can improve the percentage of direct employee instead of only 10 or 5, which is totally unacceptable. So we have some exercise or some gauge to make sure that workers' voice could be delivered. And in some countries, honestly, union is quite controlled or quite monitored by the authority. It is not very meaningful, you know. So we, if we notice such this situation, we do advise the factory whether you should have a kind of a worker representative organization, okay, through the proper election instead of the fake one, okay, to deliver the message. How for sure we will monitor the process of such establishment. Okay, and as mentioned, grievance mechanism, we are trying to have a footprint in their system. in case something wrong, okay, we could be alerted or could be escalated to us, and then we can see how far we should be involved or intervene. But we do need to respect their own system first.
Thanks, Benny. Just to comment from the apparel side, in Indonesia, we have workers' unions in every factory that we work with. The uptake's very strong. You know, we're trying to build the most responsible and resilient supply chain that we can. And I see workers' unions, we see workers' unions as a huge part of that. An amazing example actually from one factory group is they have a workers-led cooperative that was so successful that it actually generated funds to buy vehicles that they are now loaning back to the factory, and the profits from that are going back into the cooperative. So that's a very strong, nice model there.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And I think, we at Labor Solutions also are advising trade unions on how to have more effective and responsive grievance systems as well. Because, yeah, agreed that we can't just rely on the kind of good nature of business owners in any at any level. There need to be kind of those checks in order to make sure that people have a way to, yeah, to report and to get access to real, real remedy and real, solutions. So yeah, for sure. I think some of the other questions on here are also, kind of about some specific examples and things like that. An interesting one here, I think, is, you know, how do you, kind of implement human rights due diligence kind of within a corporation? You know, where does it sit? You know, kind of who is responsible? How high does that go? And how do you kind of embed that within all of the kind of business functions or not? Benny, do you have something you can share about how Sky approaches where human rights sits in the corporate reporting and governance structure?
Actually, we have actually also is required by the law. Okay, we have a Modern Slavery Act, also California Transparency and Supply Chain Act. We have obligation to publish our annual report on the Modern Slavery Statement, and we have a professional team, what we call internally is bigger picture, to gather all such information. Okay, how many audits we done? Okay, what's the progress? About our current, not only audit, but this is really, really broad, okay? So we have such kind of reporting, okay? But for sure, from time to time, we will be questioned, okay? Or we'll be asked about this different kind of situation in our supply chain, okay? But luckily, I trust that our supply chain is relatively okay, not perfect. So we under less stress or pressure than other apparel brands relatively. But we do have a very serious reporting annually.
Yeah. Anything that you've seen, David, that's interesting at Eileen Fisher or other partners that you've worked with?
We'll just talk to ourselves. So we're only a small company in comparison to others. We're just 100 employees. But one thing we initiated last year was we wanted to embed more of the responsibility for this, not just with the executives of the company, but with everyone. So we created something called the Aralda Action Labs. And so we've got four of those. And the first one is about our company. And so the way that we're driving that forward is through the B Corporation certification. And so we have a team within the company to help drive that and get trained on that. And the second area is our factories. And so we partnered with Better Work specifically and are a paid member of theirs and make sure that everyone goes to their training and events and finds out about that. And the third area is about our fabric, because that's a huge part of the environmental footprint. It's also key part of transparency and traceability, you know, tier three sort of area. And then the last area is our environment. And as well as the textile exchange work that we do, we've also helped initiate and set up the Fashion Pact, which is an industry-wide group. So each of those four action labs as such, you know, we have cross-team involvement, cross-office involvement, you know, about 10 people across our offices who meet together regularly. to share best practice between each other, but also with the rest of the teams. I don't know how hard that is to do at a big corporate level. It's hard enough at a company 100 people, but that's the approach that we're taking, just to give you an example.
That's great. Yeah. And also I want to point out, a study that I recently worked on for Alliance for Integrity, which is the UN Global Compact organization in Germany. It's called Fostering Integrity in Global Supply Chains. And it's about how, if you're a brand or a company based in Europe or the US or a buyer in general, it has lots of examples from companies about, kind of how to structure these things. There are some companies where, especially commodities companies or raw materials where, kind of rights and environmental monitoring are embedded all the way up from relationship and account managers through the top. For other types of organizations, that may not make as much sense because different functions are across different things. But it also talks about things like aligning KPIs so that they, kind of also, support the human rights goals of the company. If you have salespeople who are, kind of using kind of deceitful marketing tactics, that is going to be a problem under the EU directive. And so making sure that all departments are aligned on what human rights and environment should look like in their functions, and that they have proper reporting lines so that they know who to tell when something comes up so that it can be identified and followed up on are crazy important. Those are, there's some great resources out there in terms of, reports and recommendations and guidance documents. I've put my email in the chat. I'm sorry that we haven't had time to answer everyone's questions, but we do want to get to them. I know some of them were submitted anonymously. If you want us to follow up with you, please send me an email. I'll also take requests for our decks through that email. And then we'll follow up with you directly. We really appreciate your time. We really appreciate the expertise and sharing from our speakers. I'll let both David and Benny kind of have a minute to make some closing remarks and wrap up, and then we'll let you all get to other sessions and the rest of your day. David, do you want to start with a closing remark?
Yeah, I think the big thing that's just come out for me really is Benny's comment about taking the highest standard as a goal. This is a journey, and I think it's brilliant to see that sky journey that they've been on. I think we look at that similarly in terms of, find out where you're at, really do that rigorously, and then try and set goals and try and continuously improve. So I think that's a key part of our approach and should be a key part of anyone's approach. Just get on the ground, get into those facilities, don't be at arm's length. And if you can find technology to help you do that, then by all means, there's a wonderful video that Better Work just released of a 360-degree view of a factory that's on their website of a factory in Vietnam that I highly recommend checking out. Those are a couple of comments.
Yeah, from my point of view, you may need proper support from your customer, okay, at least to know what the standards are. Like yesterday, I joined RBA meeting in Thailand. Okay, you deliver a very good approach or training to share what the key legislation governing on DD are and have some kind of benchmark. Okay, you need to know where you are and get the management buy-in, which is uneasy, but you have to do so. Okay, and then exercise with right person. And then a kind of lobbying, okay, and or engagement within the with the stakeholder are unavoidable, which is very important to bring you assess. Otherwise, they will be your obstacle in achieving the goal.
Absolutely. Yeah, and I'd like to say, in the spirit of kind of keeping in mind the extra work that you're asking suppliers to do, there are multi-stakeholder initiatives, there are, organizations that are setting standards, which mean that, instead of three different or six different DD checklists that a supplier has to fill out for all of their different suppliers, that there's one. And that does save time, that does, really reduce the burden on suppliers. And so, I think, looking at kind of pre-competitive ways to collaborate on the buyer side is really important for suppliers. I would say, kind of, ask ask for data that will also help your business. These shouldn't be one-way conversations. And I think that, you know, the buyers are there to connect you to resources. And so, you know, make sure if you have questions about what something really means or, you know, why something is being asked of you to go into those conversations, you know, saying, well, you know, I understand that there are some legal requirements that you have. How can we make this benefit both of us? And so, yeah, you can make sure, because things like worker surveys are also super helpful for factory owners to know how their workers feel about management, about their pay rates, about issues that are happening. And so, yeah, these aren't things that need to necessarily be just used to satisfy brand or multinational requirements. And so, yeah, I think, you know, like this right requires a little bit of creativity, and there's no, you know, kind of one pathway. But I think that, yeah, you know, as both of our speakers have said, you know, it really comes down to leveling with your suppliers, you know, choosing to work with suppliers that, you know, are willing to kind of do the things that you ask because they understand the reasons and how that will benefit their business. And actually just to start with something, you know, none of these legislations require, you know, perfect attendance or a perfect solution. And really it's not once, not until you start getting into this and starting to investigate who the stakeholders are that you should talk to, what the risks are, and you know, kind of why workers are or are not reporting or responding to certain things the way that you expect. It's not until you really get in there that you start to uncover these challenges. So yeah, I would say that the most important thing is just to do something, to take a step, and then, you know, as you go through, you know, learn from the process and be open to, yeah, kind of feedback from other parties and see who else you can learn from. But yeah, we'll leave it there. Thank you all for your participation today. I hope you enjoy the rest of the conference. And yeah, please be in touch. Thank you.